Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Friends, welcome to this wonderful, beautiful Easter morning. We're so glad that you are here at Harvard Avenue Christian Church to celebrate with us this momentous occasion in our lives and in this world. If you're joining us online, a welcome to you too. We hope that you'll participate fully in our worship service. If this is your first time with us, a special welcome to you. Thanks for taking the time to be here. We realize you could be anywhere this morning and you chose to be here, so thank you. And if it's your first time, take us up on the offer to go to one of our welcome desks later. We have a gift for you. If you would also note the program guide that you received when you came in here, there's some information on the back side of that. We'll be launching into a new sermon series on the heels of this Easter morning. Next week, you're not going to want to miss it. It centers around relationships and sometimes how we tend to self-sabotage those in our daily routine. So stick it out with us for the next few weeks. Finally, you'll want to tear off that connect card on your bulletin. If you'll take the time to fill that out during the service, you can place those in the offering basket later on. But we would love to have your information, any joys or concerns you would choose to share. We honor the power of prayer and we'll be honored to pray with you regarding those. Now, I would invite you to greet one another in Christ's name.
like to invite all of the children to go with Miss Leslie to children's worship as she takes you there. And as they are going, would you join me in prayer? Gracious and strong God, with what words and actions do we begin the celebration today? Do we start with expressions of joy and victory because death was and does not have the final say? The answer is yes. Do we come with our questions and doubts because even dressed in our bright Easter colors, it can feel surreal? The answer is yes. Do we imagine ourselves running to find an empty tomb and feeling for the first time that all is not lost and feeling hope begin to push through our grief? The answer is yes. Do we choose to live in the same tension of those women that something impossible just broke through the layers of the universe and our existence and purpose will never be the same? The answer is yes. Can we trust that you never stop loving, surprising, and holding us wherever we find ourselves on the Easter journey? The answer is yes. Do we sing, "Hallelujah, He is risen," because you are the God who brings death back to life, breathes your life into our lostness, and opens the floodgates of hoping in you, belonging to you, and being loved by you? The answer is yes. Together, let us say yes by saying the words of the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you. Thank you. Good morning. This morning I'm going to ask you to stand for the reading of the Gospel of Jesus Christ. From John's Gospel, chapter 20, verses 11 through 18. Hear now the word. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and the other at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" And she said to them, "They've taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." When she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there. But she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you looking for?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." And Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. And Jesus said to her, "Do not hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and to your God." Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord." And she told them that he had said these things to her. The word of God for the people of God. You may be seated. I love Easter. I love everything about it. I love the way the sun shines through the stained glass windows. I love seeing the little girls in their pretty Easter dresses. I love seeing the jackets and the ties and the colors. I love the flowers. I love the choirs and the music and the anthems and the songs. The little red mark on the end of my nose tells you why I love Easter. Enough last night to dress up as the tallest Easter bunny in the history of our church. To be chased across the field by 50 kids wanting to get the golden egg. Head flying off, hitting the ground, and dogpiled by 30 kids. I love Easter that much. For many years while my dad was still living, I would get up before daybreak, and I would call my father on the phone, and he would answer, and he knew I was calling. But he always pretend like he was grumpy, "Why are you calling so early?" And I would say, "Dad, have you heard the news, Dad?" And he'd say, "What?" "Christ is risen, Dad." And then he would say, "Indeed," and we'd laugh, and that's how we began Easter for many years. My dad loved Easter too. I remember one Easter when we were in middle school, we went to the sunrise service at the little church that we attended, and it was a youth sunrise service, and afterwards we went to family breakfast. It was a special treat. We didn't do that very often. But I was shocked after breakfast when we got back in the car and Dad said we were going back to church. I said, "Dad, we've already been to church twice today. Are we going to go again?" And he said, "It's Easter. We go to church on Easter." And that's right. It is Easter, and that's why we're here. For all the glorious music and all the things we love about it, but maybe you're like me on Easter. On Easter, I always feel this real strong mix of emotions. I feel joy, but I also feel this really profound sadness. I feel joy, but at the same time, I feel a deep kind of grief. I feel those emotions when I think of my father, when I think of my grandmother and my grandparents and the people that I love that are not here anymore. I feel those emotions, those joys, and that sadness. When I think about all the people in 35 years of ministry in the churches that I've served who are not with us anymore, I remember Henry and Clarinelle Phillips, who were leaders in the first church I ever served as pastor, a student pastor. I remember my first Easter sermon, sitting in their kitchen, eating country ham and biscuits, and telling Clarinelle, "I'm so nervous." And I'll never forget Clarinelle. She said to me, "Don't worry, Pastor David. Nobody will remember what you say anyway." I think about my dad every day. Who do you think about every day? Who are the people in your life that you're missing today? Who are the people in your life that you grieve for and feel joy for, all those emotions for today? Who do you hold close in your heart? Grief is a part of life. It's a part of the Easter experience, those emotions all mixed together. But we are people who grieve with hope. The grief is real, but we grieve with hope because the message of this day is the message of resurrection, that death is not the ending, that it's a beginning. Because in Jesus Christ, God overcame death for us. And that's why we celebrate. We remember what it says in 1 Timothy, where Timothy is written to, and he says that through the grace of Jesus Christ, the immortality of God has been brought to life. Eternal life has been given to us. Or as Paul writes in Romans, that if the spirit of the one who raised Jesus from the dead lives in you, he will give life to your mortal bodies. For me, I don't know about you, but it would be just almost unbearable to carry the heaviness of my grief for the people I love without the belief in the resurrection. For me, to believe in the resurrection is to receive comfort. There is comfort in the resurrection of Jesus Christ in knowing that death does not have the final say over your life or my life or the people that we love and that we cherish and that we grieve for. It would be unbearable to think otherwise. And it's a comfort that reaches down and touches us deep down in our bones and our soul. That's Easter. But did you know that Easter does not begin in a sunlight room? It doesn't begin with an Easter egg hunt. It doesn't begin with stained glass windows or choirs. It doesn't begin in the beautiful Easter dresses and ties that we see and the celebration. Because on that first Easter, hardly anyone made it to the tomb. In fact, that first Easter, no one knew what was going to happen. Even though they had been told that Jesus would rise from the grave, they had a hard time believing it because they had witnessed it with their own eyes. It was so brutal, so horrific, and so final. And they saw them roll that stone in front of the tomb. And so that first Easter did not begin in sunlight. It began in darkness. And it was so hard to explain that all the gospel writers describe it in a different way. For John, however, in his version of the story, there was only one person who made it to the grave in the dark, and that was Mary. Easter began for John in his gospel with a woman standing at the tomb in the dark, weeping. She gets there, she sees that the stone has been rolled away, and then she rushes to find Simon Peter and the disciple that Jesus loved. And when she catches her breath, she says, "They have taken away his body. I don't know where they have laid him." And then begins a foot race through the cemetery. Peter in front of the beloved disciple running and sprinting in front of Peter, Mary following close behind. They get to the grave, and then the beloved disciple looks inside and he sees where the body had been and sees the linen cloths lying there, the wrapping around his head. Peter goes in. They stand there. It says that the beloved disciple believed. We're not sure what he believed because John says they still did not at that point understand the scriptures that Jesus would be raised from the dead. And in that moment, Here's what happens. Simon Peter and the beloved disciple leave in the darkness and leave Mary grieving, weeping, alone. Behind the church is a park. It's called Mannion Park, and there's a pathway through the park, and this pathway is lined with memorial trees. The tree that you see behind me has little Easter eggs on it and little crosses that are clear, and they are faded by the Oklahoma sun and heat. If you look down, you can see who this memorial is for. Bo Michael Sizelove, a servant of the Lord, 6/5/2020, 7/17/2020. He died a month into his birth. I don't know who he is. I don't know his family. But for a long time after this tree was planted and the memorial was made, an older couple would be seen walking through our park and walking to the tree. And the older woman had to be helped to the tree, and her husband, I'm expecting, had her in his arm and helping her to the tree. For a couple of years, they came every now and then and would stand before the tree and weep and remember maybe their grandson, maybe their great-grandson. And then one day, the man came by himself. And we can only assume now he was grieving for her too, alone. That's Mary on this morning. That's Mary weeping beside the tomb, alone. Donatello is an Italian Renaissance artist from the 15th century. And if you go to Florence, and there's a beautiful cathedral there, the Duomo, and you will find this statue, wood carving out of white poplar. This is Mary Magdalene. It's quite odd and striking in the depiction because I imagine many of you may be stunned looking at it because it doesn't look like the Mary that you've seen in art before. Most Italian Renaissance artists painted her or sculpted her as young and vibrant and healthy. But Donatello, who late in his life sculpted this piece, was experiencing hardship and trouble, and he did very little work for about a five-year period for commissions, and this was one of them. And maybe he was experiencing his own loss and grief when he painted and sculpted this picture of Mary Magdalene, emaciated, missing teeth, ravaged by grief and by loss. See, Mary Magdalene wasn't a prostitute, as we sometimes have been led to believe. She was a wealthy woman at one point who lived in the coastal town of Magdala on the Sea of Galilee, who had been tormented by seven demons. And we could have to believe that the life that she lived had emaciated her and ravaged her body and her spirit. And so this is how I see Mary standing at that grave, grieving for the one man who fully understood her and comprehended her and could see inside her what nobody else could see. I love the raw honesty of this portrait, the one that John portrays. Because what this story does, it reminds us that on Easter, this joy and grief that we feel, on Easter, we don't have to push the grief down and pretend that it's not there, sing some hymns and pretend it's not real, and then pick it up later when it returns. No, it means when we walk into the sanctuary, we can experience all of our life, the grief, the joy, every bit of our full expression of being human beings. I love the way that it honors grief as a legitimate pathway to revelation. Notice this. You know why Mary Magdalene was the first person to encounter the risen Jesus? Because Peter and the beloved disciple ran away from the pain and their grief. And Mary experienced the risen Jesus because she was willing to stay in the darkness and to feel what she needed to feel to meet him in the darkest moment of her life. There's a book I've been reading. It's very good. It's a book called A Grace Disguised. And in the book, it's by Gerald Sitzer. And A Grace Disguised, he's talking about his own profound experience with grief. And I won't describe to you what happened. I'll leave it to you if you read the book. But he had a terrific or tragic accident where he lost some members of his family. And he writes about it. But this is the observation that he made. He said after he went through that experience, he just kept trying to run toward the sunset. He kept trying to run toward the light, thinking that he could catch the light, but only he was exhausted by trying to catch it. He couldn't catch it. And he realized that the only way to reach the light was to turn and to walk through the darkness. And this is his quote. He says, "I knew that running from the darkness would only lead to greater darkness later on. I also knew that my soul had the capacity to grow, to absorb evil and good, to die and live again, to suffer abandonment and find God. In choosing to face the night, I took my first steps toward the sunrise." What breaks your heart? What weighs heavy on you? What is the joy and the grief that you carry? And this is the good news. Because Mary was willing to stay there, she heard something she did not expect. Because standing there in the pain of her grief, she heard the risen Christ call her name. Mary. 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 In my own life, in my own grief, my own struggle, my joys and grief and all that, 35 years of ministry of walking with people through grief and through loss and struggle, I've discovered this to be true. This is a truth. And the truth is this, that every life ends imperfectly and unfinished. But I've also discovered this to be true, that every life, imperfect and unfinished as it may be, there is a God who will meet you where you are and call you by your name. You see these beautiful flowers that are sitting on the table? They came to the church as a surprise, and we didn't know who delivered them or what they were for. And I opened up the card, and it says, "In loving memory of our mother, Marley Oliver." 5 years ago this weekend, Marley Oliver, who is a member of this church, her funeral was conducted here in this service. And her children, Cindy Drake and Mike Oliver, were here for that service. On Good Friday, Mike Oliver told me that these flowers were delivered to us in memory of his mother, Marley. And with tears on his face, this is what he told me. He said, "It was sitting in that sanctuary in hearing the message of resurrection delivered from my mother that brought me back to Christ and brought me back to this church. I'm so glad that he called my name." So Mary, she then says this. She says, "I have seen the Lord." And you know what that means? What that means is that there is no darkness so deep, there is no evil so dark, there is no pain so difficult, there is nothing in all creation that will ever keep Christ from calling out your name. Even when you can't pick yourself up, even when you can't see the way forward or the way behind, you can't see the next step, when you're in the middle of deep darkness, there is one who knows where you are and who will find you and who will come to you, who will speak to you, and who will give you life. This is a God of love and grace and power and truth who will reach into your life and who will not just promise you life eternal, but life in the present. Life, he will give you abundant life in the present that extends through all eternity, that allow you to live all of your life embracing all of your joy, embracing all of your grief. What kind of God is that? Well, it's the kind of God that becomes a human being. It's the kind of God that's born as a tiny human baby. It's the kind of God who's born to poor and imperfect parents. It's the kind of God who grows up in a small, oppressed country ruled by Roman occupiers. It's the kind of God who leaves his parents and goes out and is baptized and begins to preach and teach about the coming of the kingdom of God. It's the one who said, blessed are the poor in spirit. It's the one who said, blessed are the pure in heart. It says, blessed are those who mourn and grieve. It's that one who embraced the sick, the dying, the hurting, and the wounded, and the leprous. It is that Jesus who preached against the powers and preached against the religious leaders who were lacking compassion. It was that compassionate Jesus, that's who we're talking about today, that the world condemned, flogged, and crucified. What kind of God are we talking about today? That God on Easter Sunday in the darkness, who rolled away the stone and reached inside and woke up love. Can I hear an amen, folks? That's the God that we serve, a God who reached into the darkness of that tomb, and on that day, 2,000 years ago, Jesus Christ walked out of the grave, and he's still calling out people's names. He knows your name, Ashley. He knows your name, Jason. He knows your name, Marcia. He knows your name, Julia. Kay, he knows your name too. Jim Boswell, he knows your name. Christ is risen.
We have been called. We have been called by name by a God who loves and a God who lives. A God who, in rising from the grave, tells us that death has nothing on the grace that is promised when we are willing to listen, to wait, and to watch. Whether you have come here this day from the sleepiness and tiredness of a bed that was hard to get out of in the literal, real sense, or you have come here today from the grief that sometimes bogs us down and makes it difficult to imagine a joy beyond comprehension, or maybe you came ready in your Easter best and it was easy to show up this day, regardless of how and why you have come, gathering as this body of believers now, here in this sanctuary, in our bonus seating a couple of yards away, and joining us online, we join together with those across the world who have the opportunity to come and know that whether we are gathering at the foot of the cross, at an empty tomb, or at this table now, we will find a God who is ready and waiting to make us all come alive again, just as Christ has done. And so it's in that spirit that I invite you this day to remember on the night that he was to be handed over to death, Jesus took bread, blessed it, and broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In a similar manner, when the meal was finished, he took a cup and, pouring into it, said, "Drink from it, all of you, for this is the cup of the new covenant, a forgiveness of sins, a blessing poured out, and a promise that we will eat and drink together again in my Father's kingdom." Let us give thanks for the bread and the cup.
Gracious God, whose name is love, on this special day, we give you thanks for the Jesus of Nazareth, who taught us that you are with us, that you are for us, that you know us and love us with an endless mercy and forgiveness. We give you thanks for the Christ of the cross, the upper room, the empty tomb, a profound possibility that life always follows death, vivid in the brilliant buds and blooms of spring. We thank you for the cup and the loaf of Easter communion, a new covenant, everlasting covenant. May it inspire us to choose others and you over self, even if it means our all. Amen.
Amen. The table is set, the feast is prepared. All who have gathered this day, whether you are a member here or it's your first time visiting, you are invited to receive the gifts that are passed of the bread and the cup. Will our deacons come forward as we receive this morning's communion together?
Thank you.
the gifts that we receive in resurrection joy and gathering at a communion table are also accompanied by an invitation that is ours. An invitation not to perfection, but to participation. To participating in the resurrected Christ's love and living in this world as it becomes known through the ways that we, as this body of Christ, are able to be present within our community, able to be a church family that comes together and is about the work and will of God who is with us, God who is alive in us, God who is encouraging us, investing in us, and inspiring us to look for the ways that we might partner in this holy and sacred work. There are many ways that we do that in the ways that we share our time, our gifts, our tithe, and our treasure. As we gather together as a community of faith this day, we come now to our time of collecting our offering. As offering trays are passed in a moment, you are encouraged to put in monetary gifts if you have those with you today, but you are also deeply encouraged to share with us your connection card that was there on your bulletin for you to fill out, to let us know that you are here worshiping with us, to let us know ways that we can be praying for your family and present for you. For simply your presence this day is a gift and a way of participating in what it means for us to be with one another and to be present to the unfolding of God's new life at work in us. It's in that spirit that I invite our deacons to come forward now as we receive our tithes and offerings and connection cards.
Spirit move.
I'm going to pray for the blessing for our offering. Thank you, Lord, for the giving today. Thank you for your amazing generosity. Thank you for the beautiful music. Thank you for your son, Jesus. Amen. I invite you at this time to consider where you are in your own relationship with God, to invite Christ into your heart and life today, maybe for the first time, to say, I believe that Jesus is the Christ and I accept him as my personal Lord and Savior. That's where the journey begins, the journey of receiving and welcome him into your life, not as a friend, but as your Lord and Savior. You don't need me to do that. You just do that yourself by inviting Christ in. The other is, I invite you today to consider uniting with our church family. We'd love for you to come on this journey with us as we want to live and love like Jesus in this world. And if Christ is calling you today to be a part of this church family, I'd love to welcome you right now through the reaffirmation of your faith or the confession of your faith as we sing Crown Him with Many Crowns. Come and stand with me.
Yeah.
A year ago this weekend, Annette Poston came to our church, and today she is now surrounded by friends in her faith community. And what a glorious day it is for us to welcome her to our faith community. Annette, do you reaffirm your faith in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? Amen, and welcome to Harvard Avenue Christian Church. We're so glad you're here. And I'm going to invite you now to join with me in our affirmation of faith and reaffirmation for her. In Christ's name, we welcome you to Harvard Avenue Christian Church. We reaffirm our faith and recommit ourselves to ministry here in our community and around the world. As we learn and serve, we encourage each other's faithfulness that we might proclaim the gospel with gratitude through the ways we live and love like Jesus. And then I'm going to invite you to stand over here with Whitney, and y'all can meet her after the service and greet her. So, two final things. I dare you to come back next week. Next week, we're beginning an important and relevant and practical sermon series about how we live in relationship with others, the way we have behaviors, and the way that we self-sabotage ourselves and others. That starts next week. We hope you'll come back and be a part of that. The other is, after the service is over, I'm going to go get a donut so you can meet me over there and some coffee. But the service ends after we do the Hallelujah Chorus by our choir, and it's going to be magnificent. That will follow the benediction. Now, would you bow your heads for this benediction? On this Christmas day, let us rejoice in the resurrection of love, the ultimate triumph of darkness and death. Just as Christ conquered the grave, may we find new life and renewed strength in our paths with family and friends. Let this day be a reminder that despite our imperfections and unfinished lives, we are embraced by a love that never falters and a hope that never fades. May the Spirit of Christ this Easter inspire you to love with perseverance and gratitude, knowing that we are never alone. So let's go, go, go into this world and live in love like resurrection people. Amen.
Sure.